Hello, everybody, and many thanks for turning up for our panel on journalism in Poland. And let me introduce the speakers right now. On the far right is Jacek Karnowski, editor-in-chief of the Polish weekly Sieci. He's also co-founder of the Polityce political website and a television network w Polsce. Before, he used to work for the BBC Polish service in London and in Poland, and he used to work as a chief political correspondent for the state television. Agnieszka Romaszewska-Guzy is editor-in-chief of Bielsat television, and she has worked for the state television broadcaster in Poland for about 25 years. Then Matt Subieta is an independent film director who's been responsible for making films for the World War II Museum in Poland, and we'll bring up his case a little bit later. He's not a journalist, but he was responsible for making films about certain narratives that run through Poland. There is one panelist, Bartosz Węglarczyk, who couldn't make it, so therefore he's not here with us today. He was supposed to be representing the liberal side of the Polish media landscape, but he had to be in Zurich to see his bosses at his company. My name is Krzysztof Dzięciołowski, and I will moderate this panel. I'm a freelance journalist, and I have made films. I have worked for a number of different news organizations, including the BBC or Al Jazeera. I set up a television production company based in Poland, but we make films around the world. Then in 2016, then let me give you a little bit of a context. In 2015, the Law and Justice Party won the elections in Poland, and them coming into the government, a massive change has been taking place in Poland since then. The Law and Justice Party has promised to reform the judiciary, the media landscape, and essentially they have decided to change Poland quite significantly. So Poland came under criticism from the mainstream liberal media in the West. They came under criticism from the European Union, from organizations like Freedom House or Open Society, and other organizations and NGOs around the Western world. Also, Poland and Hungary now are being singled out as the troublemakers in the European Union. So as the change started to take place, and the journalistic community in Poland started to become increasingly more polarized, I decided to look a little bit closer and take the Polish media under magnifying glass to see what's going on. I got a fellowship at the Reuters Institute for the Study of Journalism at the Oxford University. I carried out a number of interviews with editors and chiefs of the leading Polish newspapers and media outlets. And here are some of the conclusions of my report that is available on the Reuters Institute's website. But essentially what happened in Poland, the state media have swung the coverage to the right, and its message is largely backing the government. The opposition would say it's a propaganda outlet. The conservative or right-wing people in Poland would say it brings pluralism into the complicated media landscape in Poland. Right-wing press, pretty much insignificant politically between the collapse of communism in 1989 and 2010, when there was a plane crash that killed the then Polish president Lech Kaczyński, have emerged in the post-Smolensk reality in the form of so-called journalism of identity. And this was the arrival of internet allowed, and the entry barrier to the market fell, and therefore it was easier and cheaper to produce online outlets, and this is how they started to grow in prominence. Objectivity among all the journalists, and however this desired, is not the end goal for journalists in Poland anymore. Because of the political landscape and the media landscape is so polarized, people have embraced political engagement and advocacy. And in Poland, with its complicated history, there is a tradition of politically engaged journalism, and that also leads to polarization. So let me start with the main change that took place in Poland in 2015 and 2016. The government decided to take full control of the public broadcasters. During my interviews and studies, I found out that the public broadcasters in Poland after 1989 have never been really fully independent. They were, in one way or another, under the influence of the government, and the level of insulation between the political life and journalism has been very thin. With the new head of the head of broadcasting corporations in Poland, there's been a new shift from the public to national imperative that is now overriding the narrative present in those outlets. There is also the revision of post-1989 narrative in Poland, and that will come up a little bit later. We'll show you some videos on how that presents itself. Hundreds of journalists lose their job every election takes place in Poland. So every time the political pendulum swings, the journalists are being replaced in public broadcasters. Let me give you, this man is the head of the state television in Poland. His name is Jacek Kurski. And he used to be an MEP and a deputy culture minister in the Law and Justice government. Now he's the head of the state television and he runs the show. So let me bring Agnieszka Romaszewska here, as you have worked in the Polish state television network for a long, long time. Could you tell me how this appointment has changed its coverage of political life in Poland, and is this change necessary? Is it
As you mentioned before, maybe I have to begin that I work for Polish public TV, because it's still public TV, for last 25 years. So that's my 17th president during those 25 years. What gives you a picture how often those in power in Polish TV were changing. Almost every government, every change in government provoked change in the leadership of TVP, of Polish television. So what I can say is, of course, it's I can say that it is my firm, my place, because it's 25 years of work. So first my answer have to be that I am not in a position to criticize my current president, because if you will have to criticize I don't know, management of I don't know, you are Oxford Fellowship or something, there is probably some management of Reuters or something that are funding your research. So you won't be so keen to do it. So, because I still work in TVP as a head of a Belarusian channel in TVP. What I can say, what I can tell in this, in answer to this question is that media in Poland, public media, were politicized, always politicized, very much politicized, heavily politicized. So I even noted, I even made a notice that there was a sentence like, state media message is backing the government. State media message became more right and it's backing the government. That's right, yeah, that's right. But the only thing I can say is that before that, this sentence was also right. So the media were not so right, but they were more left maybe, but their message was backing government, but previous government. So the difference is in the direction mostly, maybe in some, I would say, ways that this power is executed, but not in the essence of this problem. Right now, the public media, as it was before, are still heavily politicized, are heavily under political control, and they were under political control. And that's my basically my answer to this question. So I'm not in a position to criticize or to praise my current president. president, but I can tell you that those state media are heavily politicized. Probably, maybe it's getting worse. I don't know, but it's last 25 years. The system that was created after 1989 was to make them very much political in terms of under control of the ruling party or being the place of struggle between, because there were short periods when the for example opposition and government are struggling inside the media who will take control, and finally usually there was one side or another that would win. So that's my answer basically.
Let me bring up Jacek. You have worked for two public broadcasters in your career. You have worked for the BBC, where objectivism and impartiality were the key values for that organization, and then you worked for the Polish state television. Would you be able to tell us, you know, what was the difference that you experienced on one way, and also, you know, how would you, I mean, as your outlet is fairly conservative and, as I understand, is supportive of the current government, how do you see this change of the government, of the tone and the depth of this revolution in a state broadcaster in Poland?
Thank you very much. I think it's very difficult to compare BBC and...
Sorry, thank you. It's very difficult to compare BBC and Polish state or public television, and I think also BBC is very often under fire. It's also criticized as biased, and for example, right-wing people in Britain accuse BBC of that kind of political bias quite often. When you read Telegraph, for example, you find that point of view quite often. About Polish television, I think that we have to remember about whole landscape of Polish media. Traditionally, since 1989, after transition, we have three big televisions. Two private, TVN and Polsat, and one public. And generally, for most of that quarter of century, all three televisions supported left-wing, liberal-wing status quo, generally. You could find short periods during which public television was more balanced or different view, but generally three major televisions supported parties and circles group which lost power in 2015. So today we have two big televisions which support opposition generally, and one public television which support government. And of course, this public television which it's not as objective as it should be, but when you think what is the most important thing for society, I would answer that for society the most important thing is pluralism across whole landscape. And today in Poland we have vibrant media life, and every Polish citizen could find every view, pro-government, anti-government, just using his TV pilot. And this is exceptional situation, and this is fantastic situation. And both sides of the political sides are under scrutiny. They are really controlled by media. Not by every media, every party, but generally it's extremely difficult to cover news, to have secrets, to cheat, for example, voters. And it's fantastic. And when I hear that in Poland, you know, the free media are in danger, it's not true. It's opposite. Democracy is flourishing, free media are flourishing, and the opposition media are in quite good shape. Very often, that's true, you have TVN, you have Polsat, very often they complain, they, for example, lose readership, but everyone is losing readership, me as well. It's the general civilization problem. It's not the problem of the Polish left-wing liberal press. So I would say that the situation is much better than it used to be, and why public television is not so perfect as it should be, I would say that it's because in this situation, when you have very aggressive, biased private media, it's extremely difficult to have fair public television. In Britain, you have mild BBC, but you have also quite similar Sky. They are similar in some sense. In Poland, when you have private television, you could say they are aggressive, biased, they really have political agenda, and they had for years. And the situation that media landscape is unfair, that there is huge problem with Polish media, I would say it was one of the sources of the change 2015. Poles realized that they are in some sense cheated, that it's difficult to have objective portrait of the situation. And Law and Justice, the current government party, won against media, against establishment. It was kind of, let's say, democratic revolution. They won, and they decided to change the head of the public television. From political view, I do understand that. I do understand that. Because their experience from 2005, 2007, when they first time tried to rule country, was they were thus, the party was just demolished by the media, really demolished, crushed. Economy was in extremely good shape. People were satisfied, but media created atmosphere which was quite opposite. They portrayed country as really as country with huge problems. So that move was politically understandable. It would be my answer.
Well, and what would be your answer to the people who say that the Polish public broadcasters are now essentially spreading pro-government propaganda? They are no longer serving a journalistic end goal, but they are simply working as a PR organization for the government.
I would not defend what the public broadcaster is doing in his news programs. It is news programs and other programs. I'm not the employee of the public television. It was my decision. But I would say that what I understand, the government line is not to create landscape, media landscape, in which every media is similar to public television. The public television is treated by politicians as a tool to oppose the aggression from the private media. They have the situation in which private media are strictly connected to the opposition parties, strictly. In post-communist countries, it was not possible to build television without connection with former communist secret service. It was just not possible. It was not possible to build important business organization. It was not possible. So every institution which in normal country, Western country, creates kind of air for media activity, business and the national board and law, was under influence of the people who run the country, and it was, we call it so-called post-communism. It's a very specific system. It's something between communism and liberal democracy. So the media system in Poland was not healthy. We had huge problem with it. And the politicians who are now in charge of the country answered by saying, okay, let's keep your private television, we will keep state television. It's their answer. Politically, I do understand that. Ethically, from journalistic point of view, you are right. There is problem. But your answer, let's create a third television connected to the opposition, it's not the answer, it's unrealistic.
Sure. So let me move the conversation a little bit forward with the state television, state broadcasters, Polish radio and television, firmly in the hands of the ruling party and the hands of the former lawmaker from that party. Then let's move on to see how the landscape looks like among the private sector. And I'll just give you a little brief about this particular picture. On the left-hand side, we can see two brothers. One of them is the head of the state television. The other one is essentially a deputy editor-in-chief of the largest broadsheet liberal newspaper in Poland, Gazeta Wyborcza, that was created in 1989 as an outlet for the opposition during the first partially free elections in Poland. The division between the two brothers politically is quite strikingly no longer on speaking terms and no longer can talk. Then how the journalists see themselves, as you can see on the right-hand side, this is Tomasz Lis is a Polish journalist who used to work for the state television and then successfully in the private television networks for some time. And then he is politically engaged at the moment, and then Jacek's newspaper sees him almost like Goebbels. So there is a question, I mean, whether the journalists can really talk to each other. I'll give you another example of how journalists in Poland see themselves, and this is another picture. Essentially, this is a photoshopped collage of General Jaruzelski, who was responsible for introduction of the martial law in Poland in the early 80s. And the screen is from the television news outlet where he announced the introduction of the martial law. On the left-hand side, you can see a liberal journalist, again, in Jacek's weekly. And then on the right-hand side, in the Newsweek Poland, the Tomasz Lis, almost like Goebbels, man from the previous picture is the editor-in-chief, and this is how he sees the state television today. So the same imagery on both sides being used as a way to depict a political enemy in a way. Why Poland is so polarized? I mean, I would put it to Agnieszka first.
I think it's a result of historical development of Polish journalism, I believe, because, for example, me myself, in some way, and many other founders of current, many founding fathers of current journalistic market, current media market in Poland, several of them, maybe not right now, not most of them, but several of them were beginning as opposition activists, and one of things that they were fighting against were state propaganda, communist propaganda of the communist state. All people who lived under communism, under any other system that reminds communism a little bit at least, knows that it is something that overwhelms every person. It's the propaganda is everywhere and the lie is everywhere. That's the system that was built like that, and it was present in Soviet Union, in whole Soviet Union, and in Poland, in whole Soviet bloc. So fighting for freedom was very often fighting for freedom of speech, for freedom of press. So people who were doing that, they were very often politicized. They were two sides of political struggle. For example, when I came into the journalistic, because I was only writing in the underground press. I wasn't in the official press at all. I even couldn't imagine that I could be in the official press. After 1989, after this change in Poland take place, I came to this market where there was remainings of this old system, because they tried to transform into the new reality. They have usually, some of them had the money, so they tried to defend themselves this way. And in the public TV, they were those old and those new. That was very, very strong difference. I began my work in the public TV together with the president, which is with the guy, with the Jacek Kurski, who is right now president of Polish TV. We began both as a young journalist in the everyday news. So we were those new ones, and us, all those old ones looked like, who you are, and we thought that they should be removed. And usually, mostly they were removed. Those old communist guys were removed. But struggle is something that is a mission of journalism, that you have to struggle for your political beliefs, for your beliefs at all, is still alive. I thought about that many times, because during last 25 years, so why it's like that? But I think the current situation, when people almost don't talk with each other, there were those, you were shown those two pictures where both journals show adversaries in this uniform of General Jaruzelski, and they don't talk to each other almost. Just minute before coming to the panel, I just discovered that one of the colleagues, for example, that I know for last 25 years, that's blocked me on Twitter. I even don't know why, because he's from the other side. He sees me as a more right. He's more left, probably. I don't know exactly, but because of what? But I see that I'm blocked, for example, without any other reason, any personal reason. We just don't know even very well each other, but just we met in our parliament, in corridors of our parliament. He's a political journalist. So I think it's a legacy. It's a legacy of history, of Polish history, and of fight with communism. We don't have exactly communists, but we right now have those so-called, because it's very unprecise, so-called left and so-called right, because sometimes in terms of economy, right is more left than the left, but anyway it's called left and right, and they are two blocks. This is the reason of what is going on right now.
I would put one question to Jacek before we're going to move on to his history. What led you and your weekly to eventually get into this battle of covers on the weekly covers? I mean, how do you justify those covers? They are in a way on both sides, actually. I mean, they're quite insulting. And then how would you explain what led to this situation when journalism supporting and not supporting the government are so hostile to each other?
I would say that the situation in Poland in terms of hostility towards the other side, it's not so bad if you compare with other countries. We talk to each other, we talk. You have some examples, people are, I don't know, people do not like you, for example, other factors, but generally I wouldn't say that we do not talk. I wouldn't say that. Situation is not so bad.
It's very bad.
Depends on... Thank you. Generally, I think that the side which dominated Polish landscape, political and in media as well, before the last election, they were so accustomed to be the only rulers of the country that when they lost power, they feel so humiliated, it's so painful for those people that they can't accept a different situation. And they react in very hysterical way and very aggressive way as well, I think. And but why that conflict in media is present? Because media were identified by people, politicians and journalists as crucial factor, as a key to the situation, to keeping the situation as it is or changing situation. So the media battle was crucial. For example, I think that the other side built almost monopoly in Poland before 2015. It was really close to monopoly. Journalists with different views were fired. It was not possible to be hired on any television when you were from the opposition side. So we started build our own institutions and our own media. When you build media which are some kind of rebel media or opposition media and you have no choice, you build in a different way. It's different. It's different situation. You have different resources, different readers. You think differently. And you could choose not to do it or do it. We decided to do it. So the media battle was part of the political battle, I would say. But monopoly was broken, and now we have, I repeat, we have vibrant media life in Poland. We have really vibrant media life, and we as well, we are the country with the which is not under political correctness dominance. We are really free country. We are really free country in Poland. And I would say one thing more. I've met a friend with Slovakia a few months ago. There was a conference in Polish Journalistic Society, and he's from the Tyżdeń, Slovakian weekly, and he told me, look, in Poland you have constant fight, you know, media are politicized, aggressive, and it's, you know, we are normal Western country with civilized media life. And few months later, you have this Jan Kuciak murder. And you realize that in Slovakia, country with Euro, country which pretended to be in the heart of Europe, you have really mafia in government or close to government. And that's the point. In post-communist reality, you have to fight for normal country. You could use a lot of paint to change the picture. You could paint thousands European flags, stars. You could say, we are Europeans, we are Western Europeans, but behind the scene, you have different reality. And in Poland, we have ambition to fight for normal country, not only facade, but only behind the scene.
Agnieszka.
I would like to add to one thing. First of all, I agree with Jacek that we have this real, we still have a freedom of the press, and I think it's not in danger. I agree, because of course we have those are telling only this and those are telling only that, but entirely we have quite a lot of freedom of the press. But another thing is that this struggle between two groups in journalism, the effect of that was a lot of harm and a lot of damage inflicted to each other. So people were fired. Then after that, I knew before the change came. This change came in 2015. I think it is going to be like that.
I think it's extremely important to stress that let's call it war. It has not started in 2015.
No.
It started in 1991.
Yes, probably like this, but a lot of, so I thought in 2015 that the revenge will be very bad, because I knew that. I knew a lot of several colleagues that were fired, that were without work several years, and it was really extremely difficult situation to be so-called right journalist in Poland, for example, in 2001 or 2002 or 2008 or 2009. Because you couldn't find your place, like Jacek said, you had to create your own media, and they did it. For example, they were fired and they did it. So I knew that revenge will be very bad, unfortunately. And here I don't see any way out of this, because I am sure absolutely when there will be any change, political change in Poland, there will be unbelievable purges in television and radio. Those people will be all fired out if I will be there, so maybe I am for 25 years, maybe I will. Maybe I would survive, but it will be very, very difficult situation.
Well, Donny, we have this rare opportunity to see the pro-governmental journalist here too, we will have a session, we'll allow time for questions, so just we're going to give it a further 30 minutes for this. But as Bartosz has not arrived here and we are lacking the liberal voice, some of the liberal journalists in Poland would say that they come under fire and come under attack from the government on a number of occasions. One is access to information, and in that sense the government would give interviews and information to the outlets that are essentially backing the government. They would probably argue that the government has rechanneled funding in the shape of advertisement from the state-owned companies into more conservative and right-wing press, and that put the liberal press under financial strain. And there would be other arguments on the liberal side how they come under attack. But I wanted to move the conversation a little bit forward, as we wanted to talk about how history is playing out in Polish journalism. And so these are the pictures from 1989. We had a peaceful transition of power in 1989, the opposition, and the communist government sat around a round table, called the round table talks, where the peaceful transition of power was negotiated. One of the men who led the Solidarity at the time was Lech Wałęsa. And then the Gazeta Wyborcza, the largest broadsheet newspaper in Poland, was created. It was the Election Gazette, as I said earlier. So this is when the media landscape in Poland has been created. And there are certain definitions about what is communism, what is post-communism, when it ends, coming from this particular time. The liberals would say it was a peaceful transition of power, it was a great success of free Poland. For the right-wing press, which is trying to rewrite this history, some of them say this has been only a transition period. Now, with the election of the Law and Justice Party into power in 2015, it's time to finish the post-communist transition period and it's time to build free Poland. This is the argument. Then there's something that happened that also sort of, you know, fueled the debate in Poland and has pushed Polish journalists' partisanship. In 2010, there was the anniversary of the Katyn massacre. It was the anniversary during the World War II, the Soviet government decided to kill 22,000 Polish officers in the forest of Katyn with the bullet at the back of the head, and it's a big open wound in the Polish national psyche. The Polish president, Lech Kaczyński, who was a twin brother of Lech Kaczyński, who is the head of the Law and Justice Party, was flying for the ceremony, and the plane crashed, he got killed. It was in 2010. Then what caused the plane to crash? The official investigation of the civic platform government, the previous government of Donald Tusk, concluded that it was a human error, pilot's error, and the plane crashed. Then the conservative side pursued the investigation, and there is a lot to different theories, from fake fog to explosions, and possibly, as Antoni Macierewicz, one of the guys leading the investigation, said, it could have been Russia behind the plane crash. So, in those, and that created, so we have those sort of, you know, open wounds in the history, and then the history of the World War II, the history and the legacy of communism has not been properly digested in Poland, as I believe. So, in the Museum of the World War II was being built in the city of Gdańsk. Mateusz was responsible for making 110 films for this museum, and he eventually got caught up in a political infighting in Poland, as his film was replaced by the film prepared by the Law and Justice government when they took over the control of this museum. I will show you those two films so you can have a look. The first film was the exhibition, was removed from the exhibition, and the next one, produced by the National Institute of Remembrance, replaced that film. I will screen you both of them. It's going to be about 7 to 8 minutes watch, but let Mateusz bring
it. I'll just let you know what's the film about. The exhibition is horrible. I mean, you are devastated by the things you see. The idea for the museum was to tell the war experience from many perspectives. Obviously, we have around 70% of Polish narration, but also we have different, including Korean, Japanese, Italian, and many others. We wanted to create the museum that is international with a strong Polish point of view. So when you are after 3 or 4 hours of seeing all these horrible things, we wanted to end up the exhibition and give the audience a catharsis, some way of catharsis. There's a last room where you have a wall that is representing the Iron Curtain, and have two films on two sides of this wall. And one side is one side of the Iron Curtain, and the other one is ours. So you simultaneously see both pictures from 45th till today. It takes 6 minutes. It was the most interesting thing I've ever done, and it's banned. So this is one of the very rare opportunities to see it here, okay?
I don't know whether it's better to switch off the lights. I don't know whether we could do it. I think it may benefit the viewers. Thank you.
At the Hall of Justice in Nuremberg, history's greatest trial nears its fateful close.
Józef Stalin, orąży światowego obozu pokoju.
The flags of freedom fly all over Europe.
After 2,000 years, a great nation once again exists.
Dwight D. Eisenhower take the oath of office as the nation's first Republican president in 20 years.
They want to throw white children and colored children into the melting pot of integration.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed.
And that Cuba must not be abandoned to the communists.
There is a house in New Orleans. They call the rising sun. And it's been the ruling of many a poor boy. And God, I know I'm one.
Tysiąc lecie państwa.
Czy w Polsce są żydowscy nacjonaliści? Towarzysze, na pewno tak odpowiadamy.
Down in you, stała się silniejsza, a Polakom zaczęło żyć się lepiej.
To zdanie niesione razem. Bez wspólna.
Yes, I am an islander.
Mamy prawego strajku.
Stan wojenny.
Za następny tydzień postanowimy już nie dłużej.
I want to thank the American people for the affection and support for our troops on the road.
And today we're introducing iPhone.
And the Jewish people are building Jerusalem today. It is time to show the flexibility and common sense.
Enemies.
Before we're going to do it, you want to say something?
Yeah, maybe I'll just make an introduction to the second film. So basically this film was called Leftist. I was called Leftist. I was called Liberal. That's a very bad word nowadays. And it had to be banned. There was also one political leader, one guy from Gdańsk that is not really liked that much by current party. So this film has to be gone. It was exchanged by the film, who was not designed for the exhibition at all. It was designed for the internet. The funny thing is that my friends were doing the same film and they didn't even know their film or exchange my film. And we'll still work together. So I want to play, we'll play the second film that has a different point of view on history and how we understand our own history and how as museum, as television, and all the media can affect young people's minds and souls.
Nobody thought the war and its effects would last half a century for Poland. First, Germany attacks. Then Soviet Russia. We don't give up, despite being left on our own. We create an underground state, complete with a government, an army, schools, and courts. We suffer two occupations. The Germans murder millions of Polish civilians. The Soviets deport Poles in cattle cars to gulags in the east. They shoot over 20,000 officers during the Katyn massacre. And hundreds of thousands of Poles are forced into slave labor in the inhuman lands of the Soviet Union. Our army is reborn, moving west, where our soldiers are already fighting alongside the Allies. We conquer Monte Cassino. Our fighters wreak havoc and fear by air, too. The Germans call us Black Devils as we crush their resistance. Paratroopers make their way to occupied Poland to support the underground state, while our counterintelligence acquires secret plans of the enemy. There are Poles who save Jews, despite the threat of the death penalty. We create resistance movements, even within the German concentration camps. We are the first to alert the world about the Holocaust. Though politics appear to be more important than human lives. And nobody listens to us. Polish Jews fight the Germans in the Warsaw Ghetto without even a chance for success. Our nation comes up from the underground and fights in the Warsaw Uprising. Break the German Enigma code, saving millions of lives. But in exchange for all that we do, we are betrayed. The free world distances itself from us, leaving us behind the Iron Curtain. Despite our scars from the war, we still resist. Hope gives us strength. Workers' strikes spread throughout Poland. The communists lose. The Iron Curtain falls. The war is over. We prevail. Because we do not beg for freedom, we fight for it.
Hello. So one of the most funny parts is my friends, when they learned that their film will exchange my film, they called me up and said, Matt, we didn't know that. Don't think about us as far right. Please don't say anything. I mean, we are not really, we just wanted to do like animation. And me the same. I also wanted just to make a nice film. And I'm leftist and they are far right now. We are on the opposite, and we are just filmmakers, really. The thing about the film, why I do believe the second film and this narration is extremely dangerous. Probably most of you come from the lands that were influenced by Second World War, right? You remember your grandfathers? You remember how they were affected? Even though when they weren't really suffering in a concentration camp, they were affected, more or less. I remember my grandfather who was tortured, and I know as from my childhood that war is not good, that there's something wrong about the war if people look like my grandfather, hardly walking. And now we have new generation of people who don't remember their grandfathers. And I do believe that the second narration saying that bang bang is cool and we fight and we and us. I know that we as a nation, we feel forgotten and harmed. And like, for example, we read Polish camps quite often, and it's usually people shouldn't write that, but we over-exaggerate our reaction, hysteria. And I think the second film is the hysteria. So I think this is what I want to say.
No. So we're just going to do the last round of questions here, and then we're going to give the floor to you to ask your questions. History has become a very powerful tool in Polish politics right now, and the country is locked in a discussion about its own identity. And I would welcome the view of Agnieszka first to see why history is so important in Poland and why is it so important for the current government and the media.
I think, first of all, I think you just saw why it is so important, because the second film, in my opinion, very good film. In my opinion, I think it was in this place when it was done. I feel that good film is a film that answers or responds to people's feelings, and for example, it responds to my feelings. My family, my whole family, fought in the Second World War in this way or another, and they were forced to fight. They were not going into another country. They were just defending their own country. And my parents were active in opposition movement in Poland, and I was myself was active in opposition movement in Poland. And of course, this is our simplification, saying that we are so good and so always. Of course, it's not in the real life. There is no people or no nation that is very good entirely, and it's not bad at all, and so on. But I think when we are looking for, like for example, children are looking for role model, and we as a nation are looking for a role model, we as a society are looking for a role model, that's our kind of a role model, because I don't see, you say, it's bad. Yes, we shouldn't be fighting. Yes, so we shouldn't have a Poland right now, probably, if we wouldn't fight. So I think this kind of picture that shows that everything is mixed with everything. What basically we can do, of course, we can show that everything is mixed with everything, and there is shooting there and there and there, and all shootings are bad, and killing people is bad, and it's better to be healthy and young than to be ill, old, and poor. Of course, it's better to be, and peace is better than war. Of course, it's better. But the question is not peace is whether peace is better than war. The question is what to do if you encounter injustice, when you are lack of freedom and so on, oppression. You can put up with it, or you can be against that. You can fight. So I think that's my narrative. In sense, of course, it's very oversimplified. It's kind of a computer game aesthetics. But anyway, I understand this narrative, and I understand that if this kind of narrative was lacking in Poland, it should find its place, because it is we people that feel like me, like I feel, we are entitled to have our voice listened to.
Let me give Jacek a minute if you want to sum it up, and then I want to move to questions, because I believe some people are eager to ask a few.
Poland, Poles suffered a lot, really a lot. We lost 6 million citizens, 3 million Jews, 3 million Poles. We were attacked from both sides. We lost independence for half a century. We paid extremely high price, incomparable to any other European nation and state. We were decapitated in terms of our intelligentsia elites. We were enslaved, and it's not funny. It's just not funny. And when you tell Poles, let's build funny museums about your history, people think and say it's not funny. It's serious question, serious matter. It's really serious. It's painful. It's your family history. It's your nation's history. And I think we have the right to tell our story. Tell with every white and black side. But as a nation, we passed this 20th century exam perfectly. We fought against both totalitarianism from the first day to the last day. We did not collaborate with Germans or Nazis. We really passed that exam, and we have the right to tell the story. Tell the people from Armenia, do not tell the story of your carnage from the Turkish hands. Do not tell that story. Please tell about Armenian cuisine, Armenian singers. And they say, we want museum about our history, real history. And we have the right to build museums which tell Polish history. And one important thing, Poland was occupied by Soviet communists for half century. And communists were successful. They created new elite. They created new journalists, new lawyers, new doctors, new writers. Every occupation was really created from new people. They created new so-called new intelligentsia, but they were not so successful to destroy the previous elites, the right Polish elites. So we have, some people say that today in Poland we have still the battle. It's the battle between third generation of home army rulers and third generation of SB, the Communist Secret Service activists or communist activists. So it's prolonged war, but it's real. It's about something. And it's easy to say, let's finish, we are 21st century Europe. But the question is your country real or it's fake? Will you allow other people to come to your country and tell, let's rebuild it completely against your will, against your values, let's build new society? And you have no right to repair it in some sense. It's not possible to repair it totally because the 70 years, so new generations, but at least what we can do, we can tell what was right in Polish history and what was wrong. We have the right to say that because we have the duty to remember about the victims, those fighters from Polish Warsaw Uprising, those people, 1.5 million who were transferred to Siberia and, you know, one third maybe went back to Poland. From those soldiers from the Battle of Britain, from every battle in Second World War, we have to remember about them.
We'll be moving on. As you can see, this is a very powerful discussion about the history and identity and who come. I mean, it's a complicated history and a very, very painful for a lot of Polish people. So before we go to questions, just a last stark reminder of covers that on the left-hand side, this is the Islamic rape on Europe. On the other hand, it's the rape on Poland, the liberals versus conservatives in Poland. Carry on discussing about the place of Poland in Europe and of Polish identity and what is it to be Polish patriot, etc., etc. So now over, you know, the perception of Poland in the West is not particularly favorable at the moment, but please ask any questions. I would like you to ask questions directly, and we're not going to be running the every question for everybody.
Hello, my name is Lily. I work for the European Press Prize. We have an interesting panel on media ownership, which might be interesting in continuance of this conversation. My question is to you, Mr. Karnowski. After the things you said at the beginning of the panel, I was wondering, what do you think is the purpose of good journalism?
I think that the purpose of good journalists is to be good journalists. And of course, it's not possible to answer in that during this panel. I think that maybe then the another panel is needed. But I would say one thing, that you have to put your duty, your mission into context. You have to put that mission into context. I give you one example. We very often stress that independence is very important for journalism. But we have to think what is the greatest danger, from which side the greatest danger to our independence is coming during concrete period of time. We have to think about it. And for example, we were in some sense engaged or active in quasi-political activity during the period between 2010 and 2015. But we served the society because our thinking was that it's important to give society full information to oppose the monopoly. We thought it was important to oppose monopoly during this period. I thought it was really important. And I think that you always have to put that into context. Because we have in media, we know that we have in media kind of atmosphere in which all journalists go to one direction and everyone is claiming they are independent and they are real journalists. But if everybody is going towards one direction, something is wrong. So we were minority among journalists, and we were also demonized, and it was difficult time. But I think we did what we have to do.
How much more time? Finish? Can we have one more question and then, I mean, the room was late 5 minutes, so can we allow 5 minutes?
We can talk outside later.
I'll be fast. My name is Mirjana Tomic. I'm a former journalist. I organize seminars on foreign affairs for journalists in Vienna. I work for Forum Journalismus und Medienbien. I would like to thank Krzysztof for organizing this panel. I've never heard pro-government journalists from Poland, and this is a unique occasion. I am rather confused. I have several very simple questions. I have not heard here, and this is about media, about the right of public to know. I've heard about beliefs, about fighting, about struggling. I have not heard anything about journalism and about the right of the public to know. I have the first question to... my first question goes, I am sorry for calling you by first names, it's easier for me, Agnieszka. She was saying that she has now the freedom to defend her beliefs. What are your beliefs? And what society would you like to see in Poland? Now you have full freedom to defend your beliefs. Jacek, I have a question for you. You were speaking about freedom and about that it is so wonderful that among Polish journalists there is no more need for political correctness. I'm from Eastern Europe, but I've lived in the West most of my life. Are we all wrong to think that there are problems in Poland and it is the most democratic country in Europe? Or it is the other way around. I really
yes, mostly know. You are wrong.
Don't scream.
It's my answer to that.
Why are
you are because you, as you said, you were never listening to other journalists than from one side. That's what you said before. So we are this other part, and to have a right to know, you have to listen both sides. We are the side you never had the opportunity to listen to. So listen to us right now.
I am, and I didn't scream at you.
Okay.
That's how we roll in Poland. Welcome.
But I wanted to say many thanks to the organizers for making this panel happen, and thank you very much, all of you, for attendance. Thank you.